गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, आज प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द वायरस कैरेक्टरिस्टिक, worm characteristics and the vector of propagation with respect to the various worms, okay, and the other features with respect to the worms. Then worm propagation model with respect to simple epidemic model and also the KM models. Okay, and also we discussed about the mobile malware and using the Bluetooth technology, how to provide the security. Basically, the Bluetooth technology makes uses of the link key security, that security at the link level with the usage of a link key. Okay, so now let us see the concepts of the botnets. Botnets, okay, is nothing but the compromised computers. It is an array of compromised computers or the boots connected to the internet, and it is remotely controlled by a bootmaster. Okay. The earliest botnets were a collection of the zombies that participated in distributed denial of service attacks, DDoS attacks. Okay, so again, the botnets are often used to send spam mail on behalf of the third parties. For example, the bot programs may contain keyloggers and other forms of spyware that capture sensitive personal information such as passwords and credit card numbers and send those information to the bootmaster. That is in the with respect to diagram, we are going to discuss about the how the bots and bootmaster will be interacting with each other in the next diagram. Okay, and also the botnets have been used as an extortion tool, that is like pay up or your website will be bombarded by a DDoS attack. Okay, so now as usual, we are discussing the discussing about the viruses and worms, we know how a machine can behave as a malicious, that is malware machines. Okay, how a machine can act as a malware which is going to inject the infectious code to the other nodes who request for the files. So here, how a computer become a bot. So similarly, the bot are created in a ways similar to many of the traditional Trojan, worm or viruses infections. Okay, a common vector of propagation is email that contains an infected attachment. Through the email also it can spread the infections. And similarly, when a user downloads a malicious web page containing the scripts which exploits the vulnerabilities in certain browsers or application software. Okay, through that is by downloading the malicious web page also, okay, it can spread the infectious to the user's systems. A bot infection may also be propagated by the bots themselves by scanning the internet for vulnerable machines. That is, the bot will search for the targets, and for the selected targets, it will propagate the infections. Okay, that is also one more method. That is, it can spread the infections with the usage of the email, or when a user download the malicious web page, where that web page may has the scripts which are embedded by the bots. Okay, or a bot can select the various targets to spread the infections. So one more thing is open file shares and IRC. IRC stand for Internet Relay Chat. Okay, that is IRC multicast messages have also been widely used by the bots to spread the infections. Okay, so the basic difference between the bot and a computer infected by a traditional worm or viruses or the Trojan is that the bot needs to communicate with specific nodes in the botnet to receive the fresh commands. Okay, so once the bots, each of the bots gets the fresh commands, okay, then only it is going to spread the infections to the other systems. Okay, so and also the bot may be ordered to send the spam, like to launch a DDoS attack on the site, for example, abc.com, starting at the particular time, 14 hours on this particular date. Some of the nodes in the botnet play the role of the command and control servers. They receive the commands from the bot master and disseminate these to the rest of the bots. Okay, that is, the various machines will be identified as the bots in a network, and these bots will be receiving the various commands from the command and the control servers, CNC servers, where these CNC servers are also a bots. Okay, that is, this command and control servers will again receives the commands from the main bot, who is known as a bot master. Okay, that is, from the bot master, the commands will be sent to the command and control servers, who is again a bot in a network. And from the command and control servers, these commands will be disseminated to the other bots present in the network. So as a case study, we are seeing here the Storm botnet. That is, it was detected in Jan 2007. The other names for this is PCOM, Newer, and Zelatin. Bots in the Storm botnet are infected in stages. In the Storm botnet, again, we have the bots which are connected, and this will be infected in stages. And the method, that is the vector for propagating the primary infection, appear to be, for example, the email or the infected websites. Email will be sent to the sensational subject. That is, it will make use of a command. When the email was sent, okay, the sensational subject lines like 230 die or as storm batters Europe. Okay, such a command can be sent when the email is used. Similarly, the users were lured into downloading the free but infected files from the websites containing the music or various pop artists. That is, here users will not be knowing Okay, so they are attracted to download the various files which are freely available. Okay, but these are all the infected ones which they are going to download. The primary infection instructed the victim to join the Storm botnet, which is embedded in the overnet peer-to-peer network. Okay, again, the Storm botnet is constructed with the usage of a peer-to-peer network, and we are going to call this peer-to-peer network as a overnet peer-to-peer network because of some architectural constraints. Okay, we are going to discuss what is overnet peer-to-peer network now. Okay, where the Storm botnet will be embedded in this network. Okay, so the overnet peer-to-peer network is based on the protocol known as Kademlia protocol, which employs the distributed hash table based routing protocol. Since it is using a hash table concept, obviously the key will be used for searching the value. Okay, so for example, if X is one of the peer who searches for the file, then it could be replied with the IP address and the port number of the hosting file. Okay, let us call that peer as the peer Y. That is, peer Y has the file for which X is searching. So once the IP address and the port number of the peer Y is sent to the X, X could contact Y to obtain the file. Okay, so here we are seeing a diagram with respect to the botnets using the peer-to-peer network. Okay, where we have the main bot known as a bot master. Then this bot master is connected with the other nodes which are recognized as the bots in the peer-to-peer network. Okay, so these bots, where the first three nodes with the cross mark, what we are seeing here are the bots which are connected to the bot master. Okay, so these three bots which is present in a peer-to-peer network, okay, are called as the command and control servers. Okay, because these three bots which is present in this inside oval shape are called as the command and control servers. They will be receiving the commands from the bot master. Okay, so they receive these commands from the bot master and they will disseminate this to the rest of the bots. Okay, the rest of the bots. Here we have the peer-to-peer network where we have the bots and the other normal nodes. Okay, these normal nodes can send a request command, okay, to the various other nodes present in the network. Okay, but he is not aware that the bots are present in the network. So when a request is sent, the request can be processed by the bot and sending the infected file to the other normal nodes who is making the request. Okay, so now we have in this diagram, we have three command and control servers who will receive the commands from the bot master. So these servers will be, these bot servers will be sending the commands to the remaining bots, what we are seeing here in the network. Okay, with the node marked with cross mark. Okay, so that is, the bot master dynamically selects the set of the bots to disseminate commands or the URLs. Okay, the bot master can send the commands or the URLs from where the code should be downloaded, telling that information to the bots which he is going to select. That is the command and control servers. Okay, and here also we are seeing that is, the each bot, okay, or the various bots okay, are dynamically changing the set of the URLs from where the secondary infections are received, because those bots will be getting the comments like that. Bot master will be changing the URLs of the file to be downloaded. That comments will be sent to the central, that is the command and control servers. In turn, the command and control servers will be sending the comments to the various other bots. So these comments will be keeping on changing. Comments can be what? It can be the URLs also, telling from where you have to download the file. So these comments will keep on changing from, that is daily basis, based on the daily basis. Fine. So this is the botnets using the peer-to-peer network. The emptied node denotes the uninfected peer, and the node marked with the cross mark tells the infected peer, means bot. Okay, so here using this bot, okay, the initial infection, as we have discussed, the initial infection will be having the list of 146 peers, okay, that's the target to whom it has to spread the infection. So it will be having the list of 146 peers, which is used for bootstrapping. That is, this bootstrapping procedure makes the infected infected machine to become a part of the storm botnet. Okay, so that is, once the normal or the uninfected peer, okay, has requested the file, and if it gets the reply from the bots, even that normal nodes will also becomes a infected peer. That means even that node will also become a bot. Okay, so that is the how the infection will get spreads here. So now the target list, what the initial infection has maintained for each of the peer with respect to the target, it will be having the information like about MD4, which is a 128-bit peer hash, followed by the IP address and the port number of the peer. So since searching while searching for the key, the bot will search in this list first. Okay, the bot who wants to spread the infection will search for the target in the list of the 146 peers to get the IP addresses and the port number to send the infection. That is, the bot is programmed to fetch updated code for its subsequent infection. The storm botnet's designers will update malicious code and also changes the URLs from which the code was to be downloaded to confuse the security analyst. Okay, that is, the code from where to be downloaded at the bot. Okay, the address of that particular file in terms of the URLs will keep on changing daily basis. Okay, so the peer-to-peer network here is not used to communicate this code. Okay, but the encrypted URLs from which the code can be downloaded is communicated. Okay, now the search value was the again encrypted URL. So the search key will be computed by each bot as a function of the date and a random integer. Okay, the function of date and a random integer, where this random integer will lies between 0 and 31. 0 and 31, because why? We have totally in a month, okay, up to 30 or 31 days, right? The dates. So only the random value will be between 0 and 31. So the search key is a function of the date and a random value. So with respect to that the dates, okay, the encrypted URL which it wants to download, okay, will be sent to that particular bot depending on the key value. Okay, the key is now with respect to the date. So with respect to that date, that particular date, which file to be downloaded will be sent, okay, in the form of what? Encrypted URL. So in that is in response to the search query, the bot receives the encrypted URL and also a partial decryption key. Because he is getting the encrypted URL, he has to decrypt. So along with the encrypted URL, he is available with the partial decryption key. That is, these are the information to send to whom? To the bots. Okay. So this partial key in conjunction with the hard-coded key in the bot is used for decrypting the encrypted URL. Therefore, the bot proceeds to fetch the infected code from that particular URL. Okay, so now the bot is available with the infected code, right? So this infected code, that is the URL from which the malicious code are downloaded, changes daily. That is what we are seeing here in the diagram. Okay. Daily, the URL information received by the bots will keeps on changing. Okay, that is one of the method used here. Fine. So this is about the Storm botnet. Okay, that is in the Storm botnet we have the bot master. Then in the peer-to-peer network we have the botnets, which is nothing but the infected peers. And the normal other nodes which are uninfected peers. Okay. And here bot means here how the bots will keep on spreading the infection means initially we have the bot master who will be sending the various comments or the URLs in the form of the encrypted forum to the bots which initially it is going to choose. That is the command and central servers. Now these command and central servers are available with the commands or the encrypted URLs. So this will again send these commands or the encrypted URL to the other bots. Okay. So the information about from where the infected code to be downloaded, okay, is provided through the encrypted URL, and that encrypted URL information will keeps on changing daily, which are sent to the bots. So once that encrypted URL is decrypted by the bots, who is available with the decryption key also, okay, is capable of retrieving the infectious files. So now the bots is available with the infected files. So now next, when what happens is, when the normal other uninfected peers request or searches for some file, he may get a reply back, okay, with the bots. That is by the bots who is having the infected files. So when the normal nodes get that infected files, even the normal bots will all normal bots will also become infectious. That is, that normal node will also join the Storm botnet since he has got the infected file from the other bot. Okay, so this is the Storm botnet architecture. Okay, now that is, this is a case, one of the case study with respect to the botnets. So we have similarly one more worm known as a Conficker worm. Okay, so it is its design is similar to the Storm worm, but the Conficker worm uses the domain generation algorithm to dynamically generate the domain names from where the malicious code could be downloaded. Okay, it also uses the another DNS technique called as a fast flux, in which the domain name will be mapped with the 100 of IP addresses. Okay, for a single name, domain name, okay, it will be mapped with the 100 of IP addresses. Okay. So that is how the infections will get spread here. Okay, so again, the one more capacity of the configure worm is it attempted to disable the antivirus and other detection software on its victims. Okay, that is again one more capability of this configure worm. This is also one of the case study with respect to the bots. Okay, so next we'll see the web worm and one small case study with respect to the web worms. So webworm, what is the role of the webworm here? Obviously users will be making use of what? Internet. How the internet is accessed? Again, through the usage of the browser. Okay, so many webworms are executed in the browsers which run on diverse hardware or the other operating platforms. Okay, that's the difference between the webworms and other malwares like virus or the other worms, etc. Again, since web is written in high level language, right? So the webworms are also written in the higher level language, making it easy to perform the complex operations. Okay, but here it is very difficult to execute the low level operations. Okay. That is the webworms are written in higher level language. The other worms are in the form of the assembly language. Okay. So for example, we have discussed one example. Okay, with respect to the worm also, which are the two versions of the assembly code. Okay. So one type of the webworm is the XSS worm. It is called since it is exploits the cross-site scripting vulnerabilities in the web servers. Okay, that means cross-site scripting means if I want to tell in a simple way, if I am browsing with some other address, okay, I am redirected to some other site. Okay, that is able only if the attacker has embedded some scripts. Okay, when that scripts execute, we will be redirected to some other addresses. That's the cross-site scripting vulnerabilities in the web servers. Okay, now the first step in creating in the XSS worm is to inject the attack code into a vulnerable web server. Okay, since we are making use of the browser, means there will be a client and the server. Client will be requesting for the resources from the server. So here the role of the XSS worm is to inject the attack, okay, attack code into the vulnerable web server. So when a user accesses the infected website through his or her browser, the malicious code is downloaded onto the browser. Usually this malicious code is again in terms of JavaScript. Okay, these are all high level languages. Okay, so in any XSS vulnerabilities, the malicious code executes on the browser. Okay, so the question is here, how does an XSS worm propagates? Okay, that is, let us see the thing here. As a case study with respect to the XSS worm, we have Sammy worm, which was unleashed in October 2005. It is authored by the person known as Sammy Camber. So only the name Sammy worm. It infected the social networking site, also the MySpace server. Okay, so social networking sites typically allows the user to create and edit their profiles. We have various social networking, right? Okay, so which are stored on the site and are accessible to the other members of the social networking group. Okay, so for example, we have the Facebook account as an example, right? So here what happens, how this Sammy worms will get spread. Okay, so I have a Sammy server, that is, or a Sammy as a user, let us assume. Okay, here Sammy, what he will do is he will add a bunch of Java carefully crafted JavaScript to his profile. Okay, Sammy is there in a social networking. What he will do is he will add a bunch of carefully crafted JavaScript to his profile. Therefore, now what happens when another visitor visits to Sammy's website? Say we have the visitor V1. When he visits the Sammy's website, and let us assume he will download the Sammy's profile on his browser. Okay, so what happens here? The Sammy, in the Sammy website, already he has the malicious JavaScript which is embedded. So when a visitor downloads the Sammy's profile on his browser, this JavaScript in the Sammy's profile will get executed. Okay, so now when the Sammy's JavaScript will get executed, it causes the visitor V1, okay, that is in the visitor V1 profiles, the Sammy will also get added as a friend. That is, the Sammy is now a friend of the visitor 1. So like that, now visitor 1 has a Sammy. Now when another person, let us assume the visitor V2 visits the visitor 1's profiles, since V1 is having a Sammy as a friend, when the V2 has visited V2, now if he opens the again the Sammy's details again, the Sammy will get added into the V2 profile also. Okay, it is like a chain action. Okay, so within 20 hours of the first visit to Sammy's profile, the Sammy had been added as a friend to more than a million user profiles. Okay, that is, the rate of the spread is faster than that of the code red worm, what we have discussed already. The code red uses which vector of propagation? It uses internet scanning worms method. Okay, so that method is slow, okay, compared to this Sammy's worm spread of propagation. Okay, so now the one more question which arises is, how did the worm will get spread and why did it spread so fast? Okay, since the Sammy is making use of a malicious JavaScript which will get uploaded itself onto the V1's profile on the MySpace server, V1 profile is get infected. So this is done because with the HTTP post request sent from the browser to the server, right, that would cause the screen to freeze between sending the request and receiving the HTTP response from the server. That is the role of the JavaScript here. Okay, this is going to freeze the screen, okay, in between this request and reply messages. So now to ensure that the viewer had a normal screen experience, the Sammy's JavaScript created an XML HTTP request object. Okay, because your viewer should not come to know that this type of attacking is taking place. So now what Sammy will do is, that is, the Sammy's JavaScript created an XML HTTP request object which was used to send the malicious JavaScript to the MySpace server. Okay, that is where the role of the Sammy's JavaScript. So now, unlike the regular HTTP request, the message from the XML HTTP request object from the Sammy is asynchronous and runs in the background. Okay, so here we have the one script example where we are seeing the Sammy's JavaScript which is included in the division tag, div tag. We know that application of the division tag, that is, while creation of the various rows, okay, or the segments, we will making use of the division command. Now we have the expression expr is equal to is telling the JavaScript here, and the style is background, and in the background to execute is telling URL, that is from where the JavaScript should get executed. That is, we have the URL is JavaScript. Okay, that is execute the JavaScript in the background and telling to evaluate the document, the file known as document.all.mycode.expr. Here the script is written in two lines. It is not the continuous one. The script is written in two lines, and the script is embedded within the division div tag. So when this type of the tags are executed, obviously the MySpace server will filter the many suspicious tags. It can filter out the tags like script, body, the various other HTML tags, right? So even though the suspicious tags were filtered out by the MySpace server, how the infection is going to spread? That is the question here, right? So that is, here the script, what is the meaning of the script? It instructed the browser to execute the expression, okay, using the function known as eval. Eval, we have eval here, eval of document.all.mycode.expr. But here what happens is, not all the browsers will execute the JavaScript which is contained in div tag, but some did cooperate with the SAMI and thus aided the spread of the worm. That is, we can also have the compromised machines, compromised servers also, which helps the SAMI, okay, in spreading the infection. That is, this code may not be executed by all the browsers. Some may cooperate with the SAMI, helping him to spread the worm. Okay, so that is how the infection will get spread. And one more point to remember here is, the keyword JavaScript is also filtered by the MySpace server, right? So how did it manage to persist in infected user profiles on the MySpace server? That is one more question. So here the answer is, we have the SAMI who has written the JavaScript, okay, on two lines, as we are seeing here in the div tag, right? So here what happens, fortunately for SAMI, this was not detected by the MySpace server. Okay, so only the SAMI's JavaScript will get executed, and he will be infecting the server. And one more thing is, the most browsers were able to fuse Java and the script. Here we have at the end of the line one more Java word here, and the script at the beginning of the second line. Okay, that is, the most of the browsers were able to fuse Java and script from the two successive lines to create JavaScript. So it will come to know that it is a JavaScript and it will execute. So what happens? The infection will get spread. Okay, so this is the case study of XSS worm, that is the SAMI worm. So finally we have one more small example, that is the Santi worm. Santi worm, okay, these are the worms which are written in Perl language and it will execute it on the server. Sami worms were written using what? JavaScript. Senti worm are written in Perl and it will get executed on the server. So basically, which are all the targets of the Senti worm? That is the PHP BB applications are the targets of the Senti worm. So in the PHP BB based application, what happens? It will not carefully check for the client's input. So one of the input for this application can be the URL's query string. Okay, so this URL's query string can also be sent by the Senti worm, which is written in Perl also. Right, so the server will fail to detect that this input was actually the Perl code. Okay, the URL query string can be written in the Perl language. Okay, by that is with the usage of the Senti worm. And it is given as input to the PHP BB application. So this application will fail to detect this code. Okay, and it will get execute spreading the infection. That is the Senti worm concept. Very simple one. Okay, so again, one more capability of the Senti worm is it attempted to identify the other PHP BB application by contacting the search engines, web search engines such as Google, to locate its targets. This is how it will come to know about the targets. It will search for the targets. Okay, who will making use of the PHP BB application, and he will maintain the list and he will infect the PHP BB applications. Okay, the Senti worm are written in Perl code, where this Perl code will be difficult to identify by the PHP BB applications. Okay, so this type of the applications will get infected by the Senti worm. Okay, so today in class we have discussed about the botnets and the XML, that is webworms. Okay, with the usage of XSS case study with respect to Sami and Senti worms. In the botnets is nothing but it is also an infected file. We discussed how a machine can become botnet and how it can infect the other normal nodes and how the other normal nodes will join the storm botnet. Okay, with the various commands received from the bots. Okay, students, if you have doubts, please you can talk, you can ask now. Okay, if you have doubts,